Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our Wednesday night Bible study. I sure hope that everyone is doing well, you and your family. Tonight, we're going to start with prayer. And if you have a prayer request, I pray that the Lord will touch your hearts and your minds and your lives and your family. If anyone is sick, we're going to pray for you as well. We also want to pray for your well-being in terms of your life, making sure that you're able to do the things you need to do. That means provision. Amen. Why don't we go before the Lord in prayer right now? Mighty God, we love you so much. Love you for your loving kindness, which is better than life. We thank you tonight for your gift, God, of life. We thank you, God, for keeping us safe yet another day, keeping our families safe. We pray, Lord, that you would anoint each and every person that's under the sound of my voice, those who will also listen later on, watch later on. We pray for them. Pray for their families. We pray, God, that the church will have an impact on the lives of people in these last days like never before. Help us, God, that in spite of all we go through, to always be ready and waiting, God, to do your bidding, to do your perfect will. I pray tonight, Lord, that you would strengthen someone's heart and mind by the word of God. Bless your word. And God, give us that strength we need to go on. Help us, Lord, to be about our Father's business. And everybody say, in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Again, it is good to see each and every one of you. I also want to ask, the prayer team has been notified already, but we also want to ask our entire church and family to pray for the Petito family. Some of you may know that there is some connection within our church, and we want to pray for this family. They're going through a lot right now. We also want to pray for those that are sick and afflicted. Let's continue to pray for people who are struggling with cancers and all kinds of diseases that's threatening to take their lives, but we know we have a God that is well able. Tonight, I want to go to the Word of God in Matthew chapter 9 and beginning at verse 35. And Matthew chapter 9, verse 35, we see Jesus is talking about none other but the kingdom. And of course, our title for our series is My Father's Business. And tonight's subtitle is The Lord of the Harvest, the Lord of the Harvest, which we will see in this scripture. Often we think of ourselves as Christians as needy individuals, people who are just trying to live and people that are just trying to just make it from day to day. You know, we all have our various brands of problems and issues, idiosyncrasies. Our trials and tribulations are great. We can tell stories. But what about the kingdom of God? At the end of the day, why did he call us? Why did he bless us with his precious Holy Spirit? This wonderful power that when Jesus said to his apostles, when you receive this power, you're going to be witnesses unto me. He was talking about his Father's business. Let's go to Matthew chapter 9, and we're going to read verses 35 through 38. And it says, and Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest is truly plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he may send forth laborers into the harvest. In view of the abundant harvest and the need for reapers, that's laborers, the Lord told his disciples to cry out to the Lord of the harvest to send laborers into the field. It is an unselfish prayer. It is the power through which blessings can come to others and to us. The Father is Lord of the harvest. And when we pray, we must pray for him to prepare and send laborers to reap the harvest of souls. The harvest of souls. Now, why does he ask his disciples to pray? Remember, Jesus said that you have not because you ask not. We've been talking about our ability as the people of God to take dominion, to declare the thing that we desire to see. And when the will of God is with us and we begin to speak, we are speaking on behalf of God. And when it comes to his kingdom, God will open every doors. When it comes to your life, God will open doors that fits into his will for your life and mine. If God is the Lord of the harvest, isn't he aware of the need? Isn't he aware that people out there need to be saved? But the Bible says that God has chosen the foolishness of preaching to save those who believe, to save the lost, that is. And it's important for us as the people of God to know, as the Bible tells us, that how will they hear without a preacher? Not everybody may be a pastor or a minister, but we're all witnesses. That makes us a preacher. Amen. And so you may not have the credentials to take a note off and hand it off to someone and say, I'm this or that, but you are a witness of what's happened to you. Someone once wrote, prayer is indeed a power on which the gathering of the harvest and the coming of the kingdom do in very truth depend. And so here it is, that it is indeed a power on which the gathering of the harvest and kingdom of God do in very truth depend. We are the Lord's ambassadors, right? And if we are his ambassadors, that means we are supposed to be declaring his kingdom. Yes, we are living in the kingdom of the world, living on this earth, living in the United States of America, or where you may be viewing from, your country. So we're nationalistic to a sense. But when it comes to the kingdom of God, the people of God everywhere must understand that that kingdom, that nationality comes first above everything else. Now, we need to have compassion for the lost, right? We need to have compassion for the lost. The Bible tells us in John 14 that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, right? The Lord Jesus was himself and is the truth, and everything he spoke was truth according to the scriptures. And the Bible also tells us in Matthew's that Jesus, when he saw the crowds, he felt compassion for them because they were distressed and downcast like sheep without a shepherd. So now John 14 and verse 6 says that Jesus is the truth. You know what? The kind of prayer that we need to do, to have in our lives right today, will do three things. Number one, it's going to identify and send workers into the field. It's going to identify. When we pray, our prayers should first and foremost work on us. That means we make sure that we're right with God. We can't go out there and help someone else. If we don't know how to swim, how can you jump into an ocean and help someone else? But we must first learn how to swim. And there are things in the spiritual world that so many young Christians, and quite frankly, some Christians that have been living for God for a few years, they're not ready yet because emotionally they're still children in their walk with God. But you need to become an adult in the walk with God so that you can do the things you need to do. Then the prayer for laborers is an unselfish one, as we've seen. It's an unselfish one. This kind of prayer is going to change us from unselfish prayers and behaviors. And we don't just pray for just us and our own families. There's nothing wrong with that. You must pray for you and your family. But if that's where your focus is all the time and your passion is, but you never see the people out there, then you've missed, and I have missed, the will of God for our lives. And then, of course, we need to see the world from God's perspective. It's his kingdom, and our responsibility is to ensure its success. Remember, after all, it is his harvest. It is his harvest. He built this world or created this world for him, for his glory. And because of sin, so many people don't see him, don't want him. But the chosen few, those who said yes to his call, you are the ones that he's calling. And he's saying, go out there and be disciples and go look for others just like you and bring them to me. There are people that some of us are the only ones that can reach them. And the Lord will always create those opportunities for us to reach those people. And you know what? We need to be ready to be able to touch their lives. Remember, this, after all, is his harvest. Amen? So why do we pray the Lord of the harvest? Well, there's a veil which hides the invisible world from us, but it is very transparent to the Lord. God's word shows how God called men and gave them authority over men in his name. And we have that authority to call on the powers of heaven. That's right. We can call on the powers of heaven to our aid and to the aid of others. And it was about to pass over into the hands of his disciples and the future church when Jesus spoke to them before he was taken up. And he says, go tarry in Jerusalem and wait there until power comes to you. You're going to receive this power. It's not power that you receive from the earth. It won't be bequeathed to you from someone that's off this earth, but from him. And Jesus said, I must go away so that the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost, which means power, will come unto you. Why is that? So that we can go about doing his Father's business. Jesus said, I'm here to do what I was sent here to do. He said, I came to seek and to save that which was lost. How is it possible then that the Lord left and we think it's okay for us to just meander around in our Christian walk with him, but never achieve that level of just living for him, loving his kingdom, and working with him to build his kingdom. Jesus said this. He said to Peter, this is the rock on which I'm going to build my church. He wasn't speaking about Peter. Upon this rock, this was upon himself, being the Messiah, the fact that the revelation of who he was, that is the rock that we're still building on today. And he says, I'm going to build my church. So we are fellow laborers with the Lord. And if we're fellow laborers, shouldn't there be something deep within our hearts that's driving us to work with him? Amen. We should always keep that in our minds. Amen. So the success of the work would actually depend on them, meaning the apostles, the disciples, and on us and their faithfulness and our faithfulness. If we're ever going to have success for the kingdom of God, it's going to depend on our faithfulness. That's what I was preaching about on Sunday. Our level of faithfulness. We want so much from God and we believe with all of our hearts, but sometimes God will hold back that blessing because he sees no faithfulness, none whatsoever. But we desire so much from God, but we're not willing to build his kingdom, not realizing that as we're building his kingdom, he's going to open all the windows of heaven and ensure that his ambassadors are blessed. Amen. I'm an ambassador. I want to be blessed. You're an ambassador. I want you to be blessed. And so we need to live by certain principles that are written in the Word of God from the Old Testament to the New. And these principles, if we abide by them and not just do them because we want to be blessed, but to create a relationship with our God where we love him so much that we give him our everything. Remember all these songs I keep bringing up? I'll give you all. If all is what you ask of me, I will not withhold. And if my sacrifice is less, Lord, than giving you my very best, let me remember Calvary's cross or Calvary's cost, whichever way you want to say it, and be willing to say yes. I say yes, Lord, yes. But it's just songs for some of us. We are not willing to make the sacrifices and go above beyond feeling bad, feeling sick, feeling rejected and dejected, and putting God first, knowing fully well that when we do so, and this is where the devil fools most of us, that when we do so, God is going to come through for us. He does anyway. There's so many times we don't deserve him, but I don't want to keep testing my God like this. I want him to know that I'm here to work with you, Lord. And more than that, your kingdom is my kingdom, and we're going to work together to build your kingdom. Amen? So the Christian individual has a responsibility. We do. We have a responsibility. Matthew chapter 9 and verse 36 says, but when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Well, the great shepherd is no longer here, but we are. Many pastors are shepherds over local churches. But can I tell you this? Many of you, you may not be pastors and ministers, bishops, apostles. My goodness, you're not even considering yourself a teacher, not an evangelist, but because you are out there where none of us can reach. The pastors can't reach, but you can. Can I tell you, you are the shepherd of all those people that God has sent you to. And when you begin to reach them and you bring them to your church, and you begin to teach them Bible studies along with the new converts Bible studies that we're teaching, there is such a wonderful relationship that you can build with these people, that they're watching you, they're seeing how you're living your life for God, and you become a mentor for some of these people. We need more mentors of the gospel in the body of Christ. You know, Ananias was such a person to Paul. Paul was more, no doubt, educated than he was. And Ananias was afraid that God wanted Saul, the one who slayed the Christians and wanted to arrest them, for him to come and live with him. And he said, Lord, I don't want to do this. And the Lord says, listen, I've called him to the Gentiles, so you do it. Can you imagine a man that was probably out there, never mentioned again, but he had such an awesome impact on us today because he was willing to listen to the voice of God and to teach the Apostle Paul and to baptize him and no doubt prayed him through to the Holy Ghost. So we have an integral part to play in our Father's kingdom. Let's never, ever look at our own input as something that is small because you don't bear a title. What God has called you to do is very important. And so, yeah, the Christian has a responsibility. And God longs for help to have us just go out there and care for some of these people and bring them home back to his house. Amen. His kingdom. God longs for help to have them brought home and properly cared for. So when they have taken over the work from him on earth, these apostles and disciples, they were to make their petitions in prayer to the Lord, because now the Lord of the harvest was no longer with them. Jesus was gone now. And so because he said he would build his church, everything we do, we can't just do it. You know, in churches, for instance, there's a pastor. And if people in the church just decide they're going to do whatever they want to do and never go through the hierarchy of authority in church, and the pastor doesn't know what's going on in the church and people are just doing whatever they want to do, you'll have chaos. It's the same thing. Whether you're the pastor, the bishop, the leader of an organization, or the saint sitting on the pew, we must go to the head of the church, Jesus Christ, the chief cornerstone, and say, Lord, we need more to go into the harvest field. Because then, because we relinquish our dominion and we speak these things, God will make it so. Satan still rules down here because Adam gave dominion up. But when we go out there and we say, I'm claiming that community for the Lord, don't you know God will give you that community? I'm going to claim these people on the job for the Lord. Don't you know those who are seeking for a change in their lives and they want God, that God will open their understanding and their eyes to see you? And God will cause you to be the one that will win them for you? Yeah, you'd be surprised what God can do through you. But Pastor, I can hardly speak. You don't have to be able to speak anything because Jesus says the Holy Ghost would speak through you. So trust him and he will give you what you need. So God is looking for that help. But here's the problem. How little Christians really feel, have emotions and mourn the need of laborers in the field of the world that is so ripe for harvest. There's a song we used to sing, my house is full, but my field is empty. Who will go and work for me today? But it seems my children all want to just sit around my table, but no one wants to work in my field. Again, yeah, we're living in a time where we're going through a lot. But when we grow in the Lord like we ought to, and we become seasoned Christians, we can shoulder those burdens like never before. And we can be a vessel in God's hands. And another problem, how little Christians believe that their labor supply depends on prayer, and that prayer will really provide as many as the Lord needs. A lack of faith will say, Lord, we have so many millions in New York City or New York State. How in the world are we going to reach them? There's just a handful of us. Don't you know that God can multiply anything? Don't you remember the time when all these people, over 5,000 people, plus men, plus women and children that needed food, they had been out there all day with Jesus? Don't you remember that? Don't you remember how a little boy gave up his lunch, and that Jesus looked at the lunch after the disciples, when they handed it to Jesus, wondering, what in the world is the Lord going to do with this? It was so little for so many. But yet when the Lord blessed it, and when the Lord broke bread and the fish and handed it out, it was enough to feed 5,000 plus people. Amen. 5 loaves and 2 fishes. I'm here to tell you that God can take a little and do a whole lot with it. Remember, he said he would build his church. He was setting the example for them, showing them the principles of bringing the bread to him. He said, you go and bring the bread. You see, that's us. We're the laborers. And what we need to do is say, Lord, here it is. I don't know what you can do with this. And the faith that they should have had should have been, Lord, here it is. I know you can do much with this. And he would have blessed it and fed them anyway. A lack of faith will cause the Lord not to do it. But in that case, he set that example. He showed that his disciples would become apostles. It can happen. Because if we believe, anything is very possible. If we believe, anything is possible. Amen. Efforts are sometimes made to supply the needs. Yeah, that is our prayer. Amen. When we say, God, we need this to happen. Sometimes God will send resources when we pray. We can't do it, but he'll send resources. He'll send people that he has given visions and dreams to. I remember in the Bible, in the book of Acts, when they were crying out in Ephesus, I believe it was, for someone to come and just preach the word. And the apostle saw this person in a vision and went. And he went and preached the word. God can send people for your needs when you begin to take care of his kingdom. Amen. You see, our prayers seem to always be for somebody else to go. Always somebody else. Lord, yes, we need those needs supplied. But Lord, you know what? I just pray that you send somebody else. Can they go, Lord? Can you just let them do it, Lord? Just not me. Lord, you know I'm struggling. You know I'm going through a crisis right now. Listen up. We're always going through a crisis. I don't think there's going to ever be a year or a month. Sometimes the crises are piling up one on top of the other, and you can't even breathe between one and the other. You know what? We have to just say, God, I'm going to trust you in spite of this and work with the Lord. Watch how God will take care of your own crises, and he will deal with your enemies, and he will deal with the things that's happening in your life and give you the respite you need so that you can focus on his kingdom. Sometimes it just takes a step in the right direction. Sometimes it just takes us saying, you know what? I'm going to walk out of this place of doubt and take two steps forward into faith and watch what God will do. And if two steps doesn't work, I'm taking four steps. And if that doesn't work, you know what, Lord? Tough on me. I'm just going to keep walking because I love moving forward knowing it's your will. And I know you will come through at some point. Whatever you're teaching me, I learn. But in the meantime, I'm going to keep moving forward. I'm not stopping. I'm not looking to the right nor to the left, but I'm going to go straight because God has a plan for me to build his kingdom. His harvest can never perish. And I am not going to be the one to stop it because you know what? If we don't do it, God will find somebody else. Yeah, God will find somebody else. And all the blessings that could have been in your life and all the wonderful things that God could have brought to you, deliverances and healings, will never be yours. I don't ever want that. I want to be where God wants me to be. Isn't that right? So without the prayer and willingness to be a laborer, feels ready for the reaping will be left to perish. And so, listen, we've got to pray and we've got to seek him for this. And the power which the Lord gives his people to exercise in heaven and earth is real, is real. He does miracles and he can produce signs and wonders. The Lord told his disciples, he says, listen, signs and wonders will follow you. Don't you want signs and wonders to follow you? Not only in the church house, but wherever you are, that when you open your mouth and you begin to pray, that things begin to happen because you were willing to just make that one little sacrifice to put God first. Yeah, yeah. I was talking to someone the other day and they were talking about how they felt like, you know, they just needed, it was almost like they wanted to take a break from doing something for God. And I was trying to encourage them because it was all about family and how they wanted to kind of feel like they needed to do more for the family. And I was trying to help them to understand that for you to do that is teaching that family that you will put the Lord second to everything else. But you can still be there for your family. Most of us are in church on a Sunday in the building 1 hour to 2 hours a week on a Sunday. That means you've got over 6 plus days worth of hours, right? Almost, well, pretty much 7 days worth of hours to help your family. Are you telling me that we don't see that? But we always have things happening at the most inopportune time. And you're never going to be blessed until you understand the power in you praying for the Lord to send laborers out. And when the Lord taps you on the shoulder and tells you, I want you to go out there. And you will not say no to the Lord, because a lot of times, I will tell you this right now, 99.9999% of the time, the Lord is going to say, I send you. When you pray that prayer, 99.99% of the time, the Lord is going to say, I send you. Oh, you're praying for the Lord of the harvest to send somebody? I'm sending you. Yeah. You know what? When we think about the deficiencies of why we don't have anyone going out into the harvest field, there are two reasons for that deficiency. We lack the compassion of Jesus, which gave rise to this request for prayer. Lord, send forth harvesters into the field, laborers into the field. Believers must first learn to love their neighbors as themselves. Remember, I was teaching that last week. Love your neighbors. You see how the word of God builds on top of each other? You see how we're building something here? When you have that love, you put your neighbor as you put yourself. You want blessings for yourself, you want blessings for your neighbors. The Lord says, you love your neighbor as yourself. If you love you yourself, you love your family. You must love your neighbor in the same manner. The problem is we don't, because we lack that compassion for people. And then the other reason for the neglect of this command is we believe too little in the power of prayer to bring about definite results, and are too unwilling to be God's choice and answer to those prayers. We don't live close enough to the Lord to be capable of saying yes. We don't live enough and sacrifice enough over time to build up that level of saying yes to the Lord and willing to sacrifice. You know, you can't just sacrifice the big things like this. You have to start with the little things. The little things. Lord, I give you my day. Today, Lord, I know I'm at work, but you know what? I'm going to find 15-minute increments at least 4 times. I'm going to spread it out. Or if I can't do that because people are watching me on the job, you know what I'm going to do, Lord? I'm going to take an hour every week, and I'm going to give that hour to you. That's in addition to what I pray at home. I'm going to give that to you. That's a sacrifice. And when we begin to do these things, when we say, Lord, I'm going to just go out for lunch and walk, and the person that you speak to me about to speak to, maybe I can have a conversation with them. Open the door, God. And if you're willing to go out there and say, God, I'm going to sacrifice an hour and walk the streets until you show someone or send someone to me. Don't you know you're building your faith? Sometimes it's just family. I've been saying to some of you, if you're that shy, don't beat up on yourself, but you've got this. You can tell people, hey, come to my church. You can say to people, if you don't want to come to the building, watch with me on Facebook. Come on to Bible study. Come on out and watch on Sunday. There's just so many different ways we can do this. Or you can even just have a Bible study one-on-one with these people. Isn't that something? You can do that as well. So we lack the compassion of Jesus, which gives rise to these requests. And you know what? We believe too little in the power of prayer to bring about definite results. Yeah. So yes, the first problem is that when we are thinking about the kingdom of God, we lack that compassion. And we first need to have a desire for an increase in the number of people entirely given up to the service of the Lord. Lord, I want to be one of those people that's willing to give you my everything. I want you to have my life, God, and take it all. Here it is, Lord. Number two, every believer is a laborer. So the first thing is that we need a desire, right? We need a desire. And we need to say, God, send me. Help me. Jesus wept over the people. The Bible said that one day Jesus looked over at Jerusalem and he just began to cry. He began to cry. He saw people that didn't even know that the Lord of glory was here. The same Lord of glory that they cried out for deliverance from Egypt. And then, of course, right there in Roman controlled country like Jerusalem or in Israel. And then, of course, the city of Jerusalem, they were burdened and they were crying out to God. He came. And the Bible says he came unto his own, but his own received them not. But to those who believe, let me tell you, he's going to give us the power and the authority to become the sons of God. That's you. And you can do the will of God. And every believer is a laborer. I don't care what your title is. If you don't have a title, it's an honor to work for the Lord and for his kingdom. It doesn't make any difference what they call you. Some of you and some people in the kingdom of God are so into titles, but they're not willing to do the work. Do you know how many people I know with titles, but they don't do the work? They don't know how to do the work. Some people love to bask. Through the years, I've met people and seen people, even now in my life, and even when we were, before COVID and going to conferences and so on and so forth, I saw people with titles, but I saw the people who worked under them doing all the work, but they couldn't do it. You see, you're important no matter what your title is, no matter what your title is. Five things I'm going to leave with you. This power through prayer provides for the needs of the world and secures the servants of the Lord for his work. I want you to remember these five things. The first thing is the Lord of the harvest will always hear you when you pray. Christ taught us to pray. He says men ought always to pray and not faint. He taught us the principle of knocking and asking and seeking. That's prayer. That's prayer. And let us find a time and give all of ourselves to this part of our intercessory work, because that's what it is. It's intercessory prayer. It will lead us into the fellowship of that compassionate heart of his. To get that compassionate heart, we have to pray that intercessory prayer that will lead us like it led Jesus to call for the help for the people. The Lord prayed for his disciples. He says, Lord God, he says, Father, I thank you for protecting my disciples and those that will come after them that wouldn't have met me, but they will follow after me. I always believe that's us. Third, when we have that prayer, that power through prayer and go to the Lord of the harvest, is going to give us the insight of our royal position as children of the King, whose resolve counts for something. Remember that. Your resolve counts for something with the great God in the advancement of his kingdom. If we say, God, I'm focused on you, while you're still doing everything else, multitask. Some of you talk about you multitasking all the time. Multitask and make sure God is in the middle, in the center of it all. And then, of course, we will feel that we are really fellow workers with the Lord, right? On this earth, that we have earnestly been entrusted with a share of his work. He said, I'm going to trust you with it. Well, the question is, what are we going to do with it? Are we going to bury it like that man or that king that left and went to a far country on a journey, and he called his servants? He gave one talent, 1 5 and 1 10. And the one that had one talent buried it, didn't do a thing with it. Let's not be that person. Let's not be that person. And number five, God will bless us in order to bless his kingdom. We will become partakers in the work of the soul, but we will also share in the satisfaction of seeing the people that were waiting for God get baptized after they repent of their sins and filled with the Holy Ghost. And you know what? Begin to live for God. Begin to give their own testimonies of being delivered. Give their own testimonies of having joy in their hearts and in their lives and saying, man, my life is so different and it's all because of you. Can you imagine how that would make you feel? Because you've touched somebody else's life? I'm telling you, God has called each and every one of us to be about his business. And we need to pray the Lord of the harvest that he would send laborers into his field. And if we do that, I can guarantee you that he'll open doors for you that you can't open by yourself. He'll bless you with blessings that you didn't even pray for. And he'll heal you when you didn't even know you were sick. Come on now. God is a healer. He's a deliverer. He'll even heal you of things that you see. And he will certainly open the doors so that your life will be a life of peace and joy, contentment in the Holy Ghost. Let us pray. Mighty God, we come to you tonight. We are so grateful, grateful for the word. Thank you, God, for giving us insight into the word of God, knowing that, God, we can build on it. Last week, we learned how to love, and that, God, we needed to love others as we love ourselves. And that, God, if we begin to do that, that we're walking in your will, because you told us to do that. You said that on these things, God, if we love the Lord and if we love our neighbors as ourselves, that all the laws and the prophets hang on these commandments, these two. And God, if we're doing that right, and we're praying the Lord of the harvest, and we're having compassion in our hearts for, Lord, the things of the kingdom and the people that are out in our world that need a change, that we have knowledge about, that God, you would begin to just do something awesome. Let us see it in these last days, God. Give us a revival in our church. Let people begin to say yes and to say, God, send me. God, don't just send anybody else. Make sure I'm included. And if you open every door, I'll be your witness. And Lord, I pray that everyone under the sound of my voice will begin to feel that urge right now to say, yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. And everybody say, in Jesus' name, amen. I want you to just continue to pray for the rest of this week. Go through the week asking God to send some soul to you, or send you to some soul. And ask the Lord to help you to be that witness that he has called us all to be. I'm so glad you joined tonight. I saw everyone that said hello to me, and especially those who even said hello personally. Hello right back at you. Amen. We love you guys, and we will see you again on Sunday. Amen. Come and worship the Lord with us in person. Make sure you register. And when you come on out, expect a miracle. Let the Lord God Almighty touch your soul now and get you ready for Sunday. And for those who will be joining online, God can bless you in your house where you are. I guarantee it. I believe it to be so. In Jesus' name, until then, bye-bye.